My work here never ends. Those Romans, they always keep me busy. I could complain to you and tell you that the work is hard and laborious, but I have to do it. And if I don't, the Roman soldiers will bully and threaten me with my life. The Romans are not liked here. It is safe to say that they are hated. But I am hated too. I'm looked at as that crossmaker, like I'm the one doing the killing. The Passover celebration is fast approaching. Now I've been told that there's haste in making these crosses. I've already made two. They were for the two thieves from Hebron. You know what the worst form of human execution is? Crucifixion. They nail the human to these cross beams of wood, and they die a slow and agonizing death. It isn't the excruciating pain and suffering that kills them. No, it's the fact that they're hanging there in such a way that they cannot breathe. They suffocate. This third cross I'm making here, I've heard many reports and stories about it. Yeshua is his name. Or as you may have heard him called, Jesus. I'm not a Hebrew, but I'm still unaware of exactly what he's done. He's the one that I seem to remember comes from Galilee, a peasant from Nazareth. Let me take you back 30 years ago or more. It's been said that he was born in a stable in Bethlehem. Many stories have circulated around Jerusalem about him and where he came from. But he really has caused a stir among the people here, especially the religious leaders. I heard he was born to poor parents named Mary and Joseph. And Joseph, his father, was a carpenter by name. He was born and placed in a manger, which seems like an odd place for a baby to be born, let alone someone who is called teacher, rabbi, and even, dare I say, the Christ. You know, my mother was the first to share information with me about this Jesus. She heard him speak near the Sea of Galilee. My mother's reaction to him was one I will never forget. She said that he spoke with some kind of authority, that he really knew what he was saying. He spoke not of hatred, oppression, debt, and taxes, but spoke about blessings and the kingdom of God. We never hear that type of talk around here. Then my wife started telling me about this Jesus. She brought our children to see him. She told me that he was the most gentle and caring man she had ever met. Women were bringing their children to him to touch them, to heal them, and to be with them. My wife said that he seemed to be someone who brought hope to this cold and cruel world.
Jesus is exalted. Christ is closer than a brother, and your moment is near. I know he never will forsake me, he has conquered all my fear. Jesus is closer than a brother, on his love I can depend. King of kings, Lord of hearts, that brings down.
This man, Jesus, women and children. Women and children are not valued around here, especially by the religious leaders and moments. My wife went on and on about that day. There is a story about the woman who went to the Pharisee's house. She was known throughout the town because she, as the Hebrews say, a sinful woman. She boldly came into the Pharisee's house, and she wiped Jesus' feet with her hair and her tears. And all these people saw what she had done and were amazed. But Jesus welcomed her and said that what she had done, that her faith had saved her. I've never known any man to treat a bad woman like her with such compassion and kindness. Even that compassion and kindness won't spare his Jesus. I have yet to see one man survive this cross.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbles through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger. Heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind.
Everything she said was heard as she poured the love for the master from
was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. And I spend my days and my life without measure to a little treasure box I thought I'd found. Up to the day when Jesus came.
Thank you.
Jesus healed so many. I know my wife told me that she knew the blind man that was healed. She had seen him numerous times and said that Jesus had made him see again. Just by spitting on the ground, he made mud and put it on the blind man's eyes. And then there was Lazarus from Bethany. He was dead, dead, in the tomb and everything. Jesus came and said, "Lazarus, come out." And there was Lazarus, alive, after 4 days of being in the tomb. Grave clothes on and all. The crowd was amazed. I can tell you more, where there are just too many that I've heard about.
Yeah.
one story that has circulated. The one that I cannot understand that just happened hours ago is Jesus washing his followers' feet. I mean, why would someone who's going to be nailed to this very cross, says he is God, get down on his knees and wash feet? That's a servant's task. That's for lowly peasants like me. He got down and washed feet that had been walking in the dry and filthy dirt of these Jerusalem streets, not to mention the animal droppings that are left behind and not quickly picked up. Why would someone who has done all these wonderful, amazing things do that? What is the significance? What does it all mean?
Jesus washed the disciples' feet that day, and they could not understand just why he would. In one act of humility and kindness, the whole world could learn to love his humble way.
It was in his hand. He just chose the ordinary to show us our desperation and our need. That King of all kings so loved us, he became.
Jesus, love every day. He cleanses my soul.
washing his followers' feet, this Jesus was arrested. He was found in the garden on the other side of the Kidron Valley. He was brought before the religious leaders, and the crowd was given the option to let this Jesus go or let the notorious criminal Barabbas go. You've probably figured out by now that Jesus is the one chosen for death. Even after he'd done all these wonderful and amazing things, typically. One moment, people are looking to you for food, healing, and encouragement. And then they turn on you. People are so fickle. But this Jesus, I heard him speak at the temple. He said right before the high priest's face, "In the future, you will see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." He claimed to be the Son of God. He claims to be the one who forgives man's sin. Do I believe him? Do I believe all that I have seen and heard about? I don't know. I want to. Because if any of this is true, if he truly is the one who forgives sin, then there's even hope to me. A scum of the earth, Roman crossbreed. I need hope. But let me tell you, if it's not true, then I guess going straight to hell. The Jewish law foretells of the Messiah, one who will come and die for the sins of man. Jesus is going to die on it. I have never in all my years seen anyone survive this cross. But he has said that he will rise again. And I just might stick around myself to see what happens to this Jesus. Not because I want to know for him, because I want to know for myself. Can he really wash away all my sins and make me new? I wonder. What about you?
Thank you. working now.
Does he still feel the nails
Every time I fail, can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? I know I've gotta change. Just can't bear the thought of hurting him.
Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they do.
It seems that I'm so good at breaking promises. Oh, and I treat his precious grace so carelessly. But if each time he forgives, what if he relives the agony he felt while on that tree? Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Does he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? I know I've gotta change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him.
you.
Thank you.
as he ran. Spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound. Happy and hopeless sorrow and happy near the day. We'd find the soldiers waiting for to drag us all away. Just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. A leaf began to rattle, and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window, looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches, and the sound of the soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary. So I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me, and she told us where she'd been. Moved him in the night, and none of us know where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. The road ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We bound the stone in the empty tomb, just the way the baby said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. Circumstances, speculation could lift me very high, cause I'd seen them crucify him when I watched him die. Back inside the house again, all the good wish came, and everything I promised him just played to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was the one, it would not be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. I felt it came from everywhere, drove shadows from the room.
He's alive. guys. I can't tell you how proud I am of these guys behind me and all the ones out in the back waiting. If they could come up here, I'd like for you to see them. They have worked so hard and been so faithful. We come into practices every week, and they'll be the first to tell you that I'm the lady with the whip, but what an amazing job they did. It was like my own children. It's like seeing your children go off to school. They didn't need you no more. But they did do a wonderful job. Praise God. Praise God. They all love Jesus, and they have such a heart for His ministries. And this, I hope, won't be the last. I hope this will be one of many dramas that we can do here to uplift and to exalt our Lord. That's not everybody, is it? No. Yeah, some are already out of their costumes, but they can come up anyway. I mean, there was a really big group of people. We're a small church, and I don't know where these people come from, but hey, I'm not going to argue. We do have refreshments for you. There's cake and pies and cookies, and there's iced tea and coffee, and I don't know what else Miss Joan has made for you to have tonight. But please stay and join us in celebrating. This is Palm Sunday. What a wonderful, awesome Sunday to have it on, being Palm Sunday. And then next Sunday is Easter Sunday. And we'd love to have you come back and celebrate the life of our resurrected Savior. And I think Brother Bobby is back. Is that somebody told me? Here comes our pastor.
I didn't miss all of it. I came in about the part where he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And so all of that previous to that, I did miss. I did not want to. That was one of the biggest struggles of my life. I had to go. And I just left a room of a gentleman that, while the play was going on, my hand was on his chest. And that's where it stayed until he took his last breath. And when he took his last breath, I had already had many discussions with him about his relationship with the Lord, and he had one, and he was looking forward to going home, and he already had some loved ones already there. And he realized the only reason why he could go was because of his faith in Christ, who is portrayed here. Guys, I'm telling you, and I'll say it till the day I die, the Lord snatches me out of here. There's only one way to go to heaven. And I don't care whether you're a Baptist or Catholic or Methodist or Episcopalian, I'm telling you, the way of the cross leads home, and that's it. That's it. When we get to heaven, there's nobody standing at the gates asking if you can come in. We only make it to the gates because of the blood of the Lamb that was slain. And it moved my heart tonight. And I'm just asking you, if you don't know the Lord Jesus, if all you have is a church membership, is all you have is what you think is your good works, I'm telling you, the Bible says, by grace are we saved and delivered from our sins. It's through faith in Christ. And here's basically the prayer. And it's not a prayer that saves you. It's a willingness of your heart to surrender to Christ. And the prayer is, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. And you're the only Savior. And I ask you right now, come into my heart and save me. And I commit my life to you. And then you find a Bible-believing church, a Christ-exalting church. You go to that pastor and you say, I gave my heart to Jesus. And now I want to do what I need to do, and that's follow through with baptism. It won't save you, but it's the first act of obedience. But you tell somebody you got saved, and you follow through with baptism, and you start living for Jesus. Because I'm telling you, not this Jesus, but the real Jesus is coming back soon. Miss Esther, we've got a little something for you. I know it's not much. It's really not. She has done a tremendous job. Everybody's done a tremendous job. We give the Lord the glory for it. All right, we're going to dismiss in prayer. I'm also going to ask God's blessings upon the food. I mentioned it this morning in our service, but we got a lot more people here tonight. If you'd like to help us put our chairs and tables back, you'll each get $100 apiece from Jesus. All right, let's pray together. Father, we come to you and just want to pause in the middle of all of this enjoyment and praise and worship to tell you that we love you. Now, Father, we don't love you nearly as much as you love us, but we want to love you more. Now, Father, help us to do that. If there's anybody here tonight, that maybe even while I said that prayer, they prayed it and they meant it. They want a new life in you. May they seek me out, and they come to me and just share with me what they've done, and I'll tell them what they need to do next. Father, thank you for the food. Thank you for everybody that came tonight. Thank you for all the hours that these men and women and children have put in so that we might be blessed the way we have been tonight. Even that family that's in bereavement, Father, help them. And I pray that in the midst of death, they'll see life in Christ. Because in Jesus' name we pray.